This edition of the Impact Podcast is brought to you by ERI. ERI has a mission to protect people, the planet, and your privacy, and is the largest fully integrated IT and electronics asset disposition provider and cybersecurity-focused hardware destruction company in the United States, and maybe even the world. For more information on how ERI can help your business properly dispose of outdated electronic hardware devices, please visit eridirect.com. Welcome to another edition of the Impact Podcast. This is a really special edition because we've got with us John Holden, who's the executive producer and the host of Earth with John Holden. Welcome to our show today, John.
Hello, John. It's great to be here with you.
You know, John, you have such a storied career. You're a six-time Emmy Award winner and just one of the most esteemed journalists on this whole great planet, which is sitting behind you, which I love, love the background behind you. And before I get to asking some important questions of what's going on and what your career has been about, I'd love you to share with our listeners and our viewers the John Holden story. Where did the journey begin and how did you even get here?
I'm not sure how I got here with this planet behind me, but but you can find all kinds of great backgrounds these days. Right. But I was born in South Dakota. Okay. And as far as environmental, that might have been the first key to an interest in the environment, because I grew up on a farm. And we had a lot of acres of farm and beef cattle and milk cattle. And so you're really in touch with the environment there. And the thing about farming is everything is dependent upon the weather and how good you are at what you do with the land. So, I mean, that taught me to care for the land and taught me that you can get wiped out, kind of like people are doing right now, being wiped out because of climate change. Right. What's happening? It's always been risky as a farmer, growing up. And then broadcasting. A neighbor was Tom Brokaw from Bristol, South Dakota. He was born, went to the University of South Dakota. Yeah, and so he would be kind of like, and I've met him several times. I mean, really nice guy. Salt of the earth, and really was a solid guy. And I met him at several launches of the space shuttle over the years. And then as far as getting into television, I went to the University of Nebraska, loved it there, Big Red Football. And
Cornhuskers.
Cornhuskers. And I really wanted to see the game. So I kind of went and applied for to work with the University of Nebraska media department. And they said, oh, we need a film processor. So I did film processing and went to all the games free, met all the players, met from Bob Devaney before Coach Tom Osborne, and interviewed them. Wow. But actually was close to always brushing shoulders with them, because I'd have to pick up the film, run back during halftime of the big red game and split the defense and the offense so that they can right away, even at halftime, go in and see what'd you do wrong. That's how fast things were happening. So that was getting me kind of into media. I'm not into sports other than that. I love watching football and stuff. And then I was in journalism. I graduated with a journalism degree from the University of Nebraska. And I think what really made me think that I could make it in that is we had they're great guys and women in the journalism department. I mean, fantastic. A lot of them were from Omaha, Lincoln, the big cities in Nebraska. And they were from the TV stations there. They were from the radio stations, from son of one of the owner of many of the stations. And we had a contest where we would all write scripts for a documentary. And this, I'm talking about mid-70s right now. We did a contest, and I wrote a script, and I did a script on whenever I travel across Nebraska, I'd see the remains of a town sitting there. And every time I'd pass it, it was getting turning more into the earth, you know, is crumbling away, and it probably been a successful town in the turn of the century, but obviously it died years ago. So I did a story, I looked up information, and I decided to do a story on what makes a town live, what makes a town die. I found two towns next to each other. One town was nearly, it was dying. Population was all moving away, very few people left. The other town was just doing really well and flourishing. So I did an hour documentary on a tale of two towns.
Right.
And I wrote and just interviewed, you know, the reason one was successful, it was the people, it was the pride, and it was the religion. They were a Mennonite type, Amish. It was a cross between Amish and Mennonite in there, but they were really strong churches, and the people, and anything happened, they needed something constructed, the whole town would help them construct the barn or whatever, something burned, they'd all get together. And the other town didn't have that. And so I did that, and that script got chosen as the best script, and the winner got to have it produced. So I became the producer of a documentary and aired on PBS on the Nebraska television, public television.
Right.
Nebraska public television. And back in when I was just a teenager or just about turning 20, I had my first documentary produced with all the class that I was with in Nebraska. And then we shot the interviews and kind of did the same thing I'm doing right now. This would have been the year 1976, probably. And it aired on public television there. So
you were off to the races as a journalist.
So that kind of said, and then from there it was on to, you know, Green Bay, Wisconsin, stations in Nebraska, Green Bay, Wisconsin with the Green Bay Packers and stuff, doing stuff with them. And then finally went down to Miami to a show called PM Magazine, which was a nightly. Okay. Yeah. And that really got me into world stories, because they needed a adventure page producer. And they're at PM Magazine. They told me, we don't care what you do. We like your scripts. At this time, I didn't do anything on air. Everything was, I'm writing and producing, wearing all those hats, and shooting and editing. So it was editing, shooting, producing, writing, everything but on camera. But I'd find the people to put on camera and stuff. And so they said, there's only one thing we ask of you as you find stories around the globe, it could be anywhere, is that we can't spend one penny. You do not have a budget, not one penny. Other than maybe $100 per diem or whatever. So right. I said, wow, how do you do that? So I started looking around, and I'd look up stuff on the internet, and I'd find companies that would do exotic travel. And I call them up and say, I'm with a show called PM Magazine, nightly entertainment show. Entertainment Tonight was its main competitor, and we were beating them at the time. And I said, I'd like to go to this, the Galapagos Islands is one. I'd like to go to the Galapagos Islands and do the theory of evolution, Charles Darwin theory, you know. And they said, oh, we'd love to have you, and we'll take care of everything. We'll take care of your flights there. We'll take care of your food. We'll take it, you know. So what? Literally, yeah. And it found out that, and then it became, I find places all over the world, free food, free everything other than the crew coming with me. And yeah, we had a blast doing that.
Wow.
And, even went to New Guinea to discover if there's still cannibalism. And it went down the Sepik River in New Guinea in search of cannibalism, and found 700 tribes, each speaking a different language. And is there cannibalism? Yeah, they have little wars, and maybe somebody will get killed. And I had a guide from every village you come to, which is about every half mile, totally different language spoken, except they would have missionary shirts on that would say Coca-Cola or, you know, something that they didn't know what it said, but it was something from the new land or America. And they would all speak pigeon English. They did understand that. And cannibalism was simply as what my guide from Australia said, is that somebody gets killed, okay, and to celebrate their heritage and their history, they all sit down and they'll scrape, scrape, scrape and nibble, do a little nibble, all gather around and nibble a little bit, and to celebrate their cannibalistic ancestry.
Wow. So when did you come up with, take all of your experiences, your education, and then also your in the field, real life experiences, and producing and editing and writing, and come up with this wonderful show that you have called Earth with John Holden?
Well, I mean, that's been since it started as a segments called The Green Room, okay. And which are obviously about green. And then it kind of developed into Earth, because The Green Room just didn't tell the whole story. And
right.
Best name, Earth, easy. And I guess really first stories for that were probably done in 2014, maybe. I mean, 2009 is when I started doing segments at environmental, and I love environmental stories. I'd worked for NBC for a while and had been a feature reporter, and loved doing stories on people and some environmental stories and stuff. So when I left, I became freelance way back in the 90s. And then in the 2000s, I started doing stuff for everybody, not just NBC, but ABC and Fox, a lot of Fox stuff. And then just doing stories. They're always like, 1.5 minute to 2 minutes long. And they would be people type stories or just crazy type people and interesting things, but always telling a story and, having a personality in it. And then I just kind of, I have an interest, like I said, from the beginning, and just the environment coming from a farm.
Right.
So those were really, I think Obama would have been the president, and there was, obviously interest then in saving our planet, right. And Al Gore with his, with what he did. So I started, that was about the time. Yeah, that's when I started doing stories, and they really took off.
So for our listeners and viewers, we've got John Holden with us. He's the executive producer, the journalist, and the host of Earth with John Holden. You could find him at earthwithjohnholden.com. You could find him also on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Vimeo, and YouTube. John, you've done so many stories over the years no pun intended, in your storied career. Who's an individual who's significantly impacted sustainability, the circular economy revolution, and the future of the environment that stands out? And I know it's hard to choose among all your children, and I'm not trying to make you make a Sophie's choice or anything, but who's some standouts that are inspiring to you that you really love to cover and that you'd love to share with our listeners and our viewers?
Well, you know what? There's a great staff at Star Media of producers and researchers. So they're always looking up things, because, man, there's so many things going on right now. And there's such a key, every company right now has a sustainability manager, and involved with marketing and stuff. So involved in
that's relatively a new phenomenon. That's relatively new. Yeah.
And that's what's happening now, is I'm always incorporating them. But going back to over the years of doing this, since 2009, 2010, and Star Media's give you a little bit of a background, the company is Star Media that I work with. A bunch of people, about a dozen people that are researchers and producers and editor, and they're kind of coming up with ideas. One had found company, they look at companies, what's the green angle to what they really want to spend their money on, because everybody wants to be thought well of.
Of course.
I think every company I've ever met has an interest in the environment. It used to be maybe make money. Well, now it's make money but also do a good thing too.
Right.
And they found a person named Fisk Johnson, who's S.C. Johnson is the name of the company. He's kind of a guy born of the golden spoon, born into it from his family. With right away you're born, all of a sudden you have 100 companies under you, everything from Windex to Glade to, it's a family product company of all the products you find in your home.
Okay. Iconic brands that we all grew up with.
Yeah, I mean, the most common brands out there. And you, I'll bet you, you look in your house, you've got 30, 40, 50 items in your bathroom and your kitchen that are all SC Johnson. They're all separate companies and stuff, and they're all under Fisk. And Fisk himself, about my age, real nice guy. I felt when I talked to him, I felt like I was talking to my brother or something. Not anybody you think has a lot of money. You think he was just a most down to earth person you've ever met. And he's a scuba diver. And 45 years he's been scuba diving. And he's noticed really how bad the oceans have gotten from plastic pollution. Mm. So, and he showed me just the video of what he found in like places off of Panama and Haiti, and where, you know, the reefs are wrapped in plastic, and fish life are, even no matter how deep you go, even the smallest organism has remnants of plastic. They're eating plastic. So it's just like our, and of course that's affecting us, you know, the marine life affects us too, even if they're under the sea.
Sure.
But he's virtually seeing, and he says there's over 8 million tons of plastic pouring in every year into the ocean. And it's just, and you see just hordes of it in off of certain islands and in Indonesia, China, it really bad. And so what he did, he came up with an idea of how do you at least do a part in saving our oceans from plastic by partnering with a company in Bali. And so I flew to Bali, which was wonderful, long flight, but nice. I saw a lot of movies on the way there. and you know, you always think of Bali as just these beautiful beaches. But when you go to Bali, see beautiful beaches, but it's the hotel, these 4 and 5 star hotels that have crews go out every day and scrape the plastic off. And yeah, then you take the picture, and by every wave coming in, there's more plastic coming in. By the end of the day, there's waste all over the beach again. The waves coming in, leaving plastic. And then they got to clean it again. So you go to some of the public beaches there, and they're bad. Just, walking on plastic and every kind of trash you can imagine. So he thought that was a good way to start what he started for a program in partnering with a company that would called itself Plastic Bank. And the Plastic Banks are actually just like banks we think of, only they deal in the currency of plastic. They take plastic in, and they pay the people that bring it in crypto or digital tokens by the pounds or by the ton of plastic. And so you have all these people, and Bali are a lot of poor people, a lot of people that have absolutely no comprehension of how much they're polluting our oceans, and they're just throwing plastic, whatever. But now, plastic is worth something. Now they're all out cleaning up, picking up plastic, going out in the waters, you know, trying to, and every day they're cleaning the beaches, putting it in bags. And they go into town, the villages there, to a plastic bank with big bags. They weigh them, and then they say, okay, this is, you got 100 pounds of plastic here, and here's, you can have either cash, or we'll give you a digital token, which you can use it in even the grocery stores and stuff there in Bali, take digital tokens.
Wow.
Yeah, so the people have learned how to save. It's the first time they've ever saved. And get this, if they got in digital tokens or cryptocurrency, can you imagine? I did this story a couple of years ago. Can you imagine with the price of crypto going up, what these some of these people might have had if they didn't spend their
right tokens?
Yeah. Right. So I mean, it's like they're suddenly realizing, I could make some money. And it's helping clean the waters. It's helping clean the beaches. It's helping clean the rivers going in. It's helping the people with the economy. And what does the bank do with the plastic? They sell it back to like Fisk Johnson, who's partnering in all this. And he's using all the plastic to be recycled to make his products now, like Windex, which the new Windex bottle is 100% recycled ocean plastic. 100%.
I didn't realize that.
Yes. And so he wants to do that with all these products. So, you know, you got this guy, he could do anything. He could just keep raking in money, but he's just like trying to find this circular economy of saving our oceans of plastic, clean it up, turn it in for crypto, recycle, and make and use the plastic over again to that sticks out in my mind as somebody who's found a way that can catch on and get into more and more countries.
You know, John, you do all these very positive stories. You yourself are a very positive human being, and you exude a great energy that is uplifting. But I can't help to ask you about what we're living through right now. Yesterday, I know we off the air, we talked, shared a little bit about you just coming back from Europe. Yesterday in Italy, it rained 34 inches in 24 hours, which is more than the rainfall in an entire year in Seattle. It's never happened before in all of the history of that part of the world. And, you know, I live in California. Literally the air quality control index in today, the air quality index in Fresno is in the 170s because of all the smoke coming down on us from the fires in Northern California. Mm. You know, where are we right now in our journey? You know, sometimes I feel like you're in my generation, which we're of the same collective generation, inherited a diamond, but we're turning over sort of a pile of tin to the Greta Thunbergs or to our children and our grandchildren. How can we reverse that when all these big signals are happening in and around us? What's your thoughts?
Well, I mean, at least with these companies, like with Earth, the secret is we're looking at what companies are doing. And every company seems to have different programs. It's like what you just mentioned, sustainability managers. Now, every company's got a sustainability manager, and the departments are growing. And they're doing things like, okay, we're doing this kind of a program and cleaning up our beach or the parks or whatever, or the recycling programs and all. But every company is doing something, and that's growing. Because these people are becoming major players in companies now. And probably the first person I check with when checking with a company to say, hey, here's an issue facing our planet. Maybe it's, the combustion engines or renewable energy or healthcare solutions or autonomous vehicles. I mean, just whatever. Here's some issue. Okay, what are we doing about it? Well, now here's a company that's doing something about it. So, I mean, I'm taking a company perspective, and it might be a lot of companies doing that, but some companies, really going overboard and with ideas that are catching on, and other companies grab it too. Because all these environmental solutions, people aren't saying, hey, here's my solutions. I don't want anybody else to know about it. I'm putting a copyright on it. It's like, hey, this is for our planet, and we want everybody to.
Every company's happy when you show up at their door. Let's just say that.
Yeah. I'm not 60 minutes. Coming in to
turn you're not down. Mike Wallace. You're the nothing, opposite. Yeah. You're focusing on the positivity. Yeah. So you're saying you focus on the positivity of all these great and iconic brands that are truly working to push back against all the damage we've done. And that's how you stay positive and keep marching forward every day, by producing Earth with John Holden and focusing on the positivity.
Yeah, and it's really fun. I mean, the ideas are just range from, let me tell you one story I just did last month. Was the food problem, our food scarcity. Yeah. We're going to have 10 billion people supposedly by the year 2050. How do you feed that many people? Is there enough land to grow that much food? So I found a guy with a company called Iwi, IWI. He's from Spain, but he's starting up this all over the world. He's got a way to make desert land farmable. Well, how do you do that? So he goes to the desert of, we shot the story in New Mexico, and I flew into El Paso and drove a long distance until I got way into the desert, right next to the border wall of Mexico. And here in the middle of the desert of New Mexico is something out of the moonscape of canals that have been dug with water. That's the aquifer underneath the desert sand. That's salt water. Well, what do you raise in salt water? Well, what comes from salt water? Sea algae. CLG. Okay. What is CLG good for? Filled with protein, and it's the omega-3. That's CLG is the source of omega-3. And people buy, you know, like fish pills and all that, thinking, oh, okay, that's how I'm going to get my omega-3. Well, no, the only reason fish have omega-3 is because they eat CLG. So this guy thought, well, if I take CLG, the seeds, and just seed the water of the deserts, and you can dig down and it's unlimited salt water. So he has literally fields of CLG growing in the middle of the desert that's harvested every day. I mean, you think of one corn crop or something, you know, or I mean, soybeans or something once a year or once a season. This is every day. Tons of CLG being produced, and then they dry it. It's being used for protein, for foods, for nutrients, for and he calls it the super vegetable of the future. And he thinks that every desert in the world can become a arable land of CLG that is going to be our food. And you can make CLG, might not think tastes really good, but you can make it taste good. I mean, you'd be amazed at what
you liked it. Let's just say this. You enjoyed the taste.
I didn't like taking the CLG and just eating it raw. Hey, can I have a little pepper on it?
No. But you enjoyed the products that he shared with you. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. The products and I mean, what's going to be coming down the pike, I'm sure, are going to be energy bars and what, you know, CLG, that. Right now, it's mostly the nutrients and the things for, you know, mind and your body, and taking capsules, you know, just the health foods that are being made from it. And they're sold. They probably have about 15, 20 different kinds of health food.
That's wonderful. Wonderful.
And he's doing that in the deserts of Texas, the deserts of New Mexico. He's from Spain, and he's getting people, you know, into his company that are partnering with them, saying, let's do the deserts of the world, you know.
John, when I was doing my prep work on you, which was just a joy, because all you've done is really spread so much positivity over the length of your career. Like I shared with you off the air, we need 50 more of you, really, because the rest of the news, the mainstream news, has become so negative in terms of what they're putting out there nowadays. It's such a darn shame. But one of the great stories I read about you goes back to your home state of South Dakota, where you did a human interest story in the late 70s on a gentleman who was carving an entire mountain. Can you share a little bit about that story and what that meant to you?
Yeah. That's kind of neat. It's still a favorite just because it was my first story. And it was because I was getting into news at that time. I was a news reporter, although later on became just producer and stuff, and then with NBC down the road, I got back on the air again,
right,
as a feature reporter. But at that time, I was just getting into wanting to do people stories, and this little town in Nebraska called Kearney, Nebraska, and it had a little station called NTV, and they said, hey, I like your stuff. Why don't you just go out and find stories? And I said, well, how far can I go for my story? And they said, go as far as you want. It wasn't quite like PM Magazine, where they said, as long as it doesn't cost anything. But they gave me some money to go travel. And I'd always, as a kid growing up, I'd always wanted to meet the guy that was carving a giant mountain in South Dakota called Crazy Horse Monument. If people have been there, it's a monument, a mountain that's been carved down to Chief Crazy Horse, it's the world's largest mountain carving. It's also been known as the eighth wonder of the world, but it's been under carving for years, and it's in the Black Hills of South Dakota, where Mount Rushmore is, the Four Faces. So I thought, well, man, if they're letting me go, I just took off, started driving, and I thought, I'm going to go back to South Dakota, which is the Black Hills is near the Nebraska border, so I'm not too far out of the range, but it's a human interest story anybody's going to want. So I drove to this place where the guy was carving the mountain. And it's a big tourist attraction. Korjak Dulkowski was the bearded giant carving it. And he's no longer alive, but at that time he was have at it, dynamiting away. And as I drove up to the mountain, I could see blasts going off of the mountain, and you could see the head of Crazy Horse coming out in the horse's head, and the mountain itself. I think I'm trying to remember. Korjak had worked on the Mount Rushmore in carving that the four faces with Gustav Borglum, who is who was behind the Mount Rushmore. So that's how he knew how to carve mountains, because he worked under the best. But this crazy horse was 40 times bigger. I mean, the biggest mountain carving in the world.
How long did it take, John?
It's going to take lifetimes to carve
It's still a work in progress.
Still a work in progress. Wow. He worked on it for, I think, 36 years before he died on it. Wow. But this would have been the year right after I got out of college. In fact, after I'd done that story on the Tale of Two Towns, it was the year 1978, I guess 79. And I drove up to that mountain, saw the blast going off, and I was shooting my own stuff then. I was the old one-man band. You put a camera, CP16 on your shoulder, hold a mic out, you walk up and talk to people. Unfortunately, that's the way some camera people are, again, back to doing that to save money. But I went into the center there at Mount Rush, or at Crazy Horse, and there was a woman in there, and I said, I'm from a TV station in Nebraska. I want to go interview that guy up there on the mountain that's carving. And she says, nobody goes up to bother Korjak Jokowski. Nobody. She says, you interview me. And I said, who are you? She says, I'm Ruth. I'm in charge of the lobby here, or the souvenirs shop and everything. So I'll let you get in free. You don't have to pay, and you can interview me, and I'll show you the little monument that he's carving here, a small part of it, and tell you about what he's doing up there. And then through the window, you can see them up. So I said, well, really wanted to do more than that. I wanted to meet the guy. And she said, no, everybody wants to interview Korjak. We don't let anybody interview Korjak. He's got a mountain to carve. Okay. So I walk outside, go to my car, get my camera out, and a Jeep drives up. And the kid's in there saying, hey, who are you? And I said, I'm from a station in Nebraska. What are you doing here? I said, I want to interview the guy that's on the mountain, but the lady inside said, I can't go up there. And he says, wait a minute, Mom won't let you go up and interview Dad? Bullshit. Excuse me. So he said, jump in with me. So I jump in with him. He takes me, all over to the top of the mountain. Wow. And on the top of this head that's being carved, and I can see explosions going off. And here's this bearded guy with a big cowboy hat on. And we get out of the Jeep, and he just turns around, sees me, and he comes at me in a rage and said, who the hell are you? How the hell did you get up here? And I said, well, your son took me up here. And he says, well, now that you're up here, I'm not going to take you back. Get in. And then I jumped in his truck, and he said, what do you know about dynamiting? I said, I don't know anything about dynamite. He said, I'll teach it. And so then he said, here, we got to get this, set the dynamite here. So he wanted me to set things. And I mean, I didn't like the stuff, but
right,
I was
helping right.
edit. And he was pointing this, you got to get this done today. I got to do that. He said, I got 10 kids, and all the kids are, they're all just interested in, mostly sons, they're all just interested in girls, and I've got a mountain to carve. He started telling me his story. And so I have my camera, and I'm pointing it at him. And every time he says, put that damn camera down. He says, that's all you people are interested in is interviews. I said, I got work to do. He says, the last person that came here to try to interview me, I told him where to go. His name was Morley Schaefer. From 60 Minutes. And I said, that's a big show. And he says, yeah, but I didn't want that guy up here. He says, how do I know what he's going to ask me? And I don't have time. So I had my wife deal with him. And so, but I wouldn't let him up here. That's why he said, I'm surprised you got up here. So anyway, I did finally get an interview with him, and we hit it off. And pretty soon he's telling me all his stories of everything from getting a call from once from a drunken party in which George McGovern called and says, hey, Korjak, I have a friend here who wants to talk to you. Can you talk to him? Yeah, who is it? I said, well, and he gets on the phone, and the guy says, Korjak, I understood you worked on the four faces. Is there room for another face? And then Korjak said to him, Ted Kennedy says, I can tell you're drunk. And no, there's not room for, I can't believe you're asking, you think this is just a big joke, he says. No, there's not room for another face. And no, nobody's going to carve a monument to your, you know, your brother, right. John Kennedy.
Right.
And he hung up on him. I mean, that's just one of the stories I remember him.
Wow.
Him telling. And so he's taken me and then we're doing more stories about, you know, what made him want to do this. And he says there's a Indian in this mountain and Chief Sitting Bull had came to him and said, you white men have your heroes. Well, we have our heroes in the Indian lore too. We want you to uncover one. And he's in that mountain. So he's, you know, he started uncovering this giant mountain. And anyway, so I spent a day with him on the mountain. I don't think anybody, and in fact, his own family now, Korjak's dead, Ruth is dead, his wife, but all his sons are still working. I don't think, I'd love to get together with his sons and tell them some of the stories I heard, because I don't think he would have even told them the stories. But one thing he did was, he said, I've got to take you down and show you something. So then he took me down to the bottom of the mountain, and he drove all the way down his Jeep, and then we come to the bottom of the mountain, and here's this big door that says, Korjak, Storyteller in Stone. And I said, what's that? And he says, that's where I'm going to live the rest of my life after I'm dead. And then, so he said, here, open the door. And I tried pulling open the door of this big giant mountain door and I couldn't get open. So he literally just shoved me aside, took it. And he's a mountain of a man, pulls this thing open. And here's this big chamber in the mountain underneath with a solitary coffin, or I mean, you know, a tomb.
Like so he crypt. Walks in. Like he was like
crypt, a giant yeah. crypt. Yeah. So he walks in. The sun was just, it was setting sun. The sun is just perfect. He walks in. He sits down on his tomb, his crypt, and he's just sitting there stroking his big beard and totally oblivious to me. And he says, I'm going to like it in here. He says, Ruth won't come in here. She refuses to set foot, but it's 72 degrees in here year round. This is going to be a nice place to be. And then that was the last shot. Yeah. And then
he figured it all out.
Yeah. Sitting in his tomb underneath his mountain. And that was pretty crazy.
He knew who he was, but he also knew where he was going to go. And,
right.
he was good with it.
Oh, and here's a funny thing. I probably shouldn't even tell this because I don't know how many people visit Crazy Horse, but he said, hey, I want you to eat dinner with me and the family. And I said, I don't think your wife's going to want me. And he said, no. And so he took me, I said, we're going to eat. So he goes into this little, just modest little place, home right next to where the souvenirs are. And it's a little checkerboard table, you know, with a cloth and plastic, everything just looks like, you know, very, very modest. And they got some chicken and stuff laid out. And Ruth, his wife, is there making the dinner and she looks and just glares at me. And then, Korjak says to her, Ruth, I got a guest. He's eating with us tonight. She just looks at him, looks at me, and then turns back to cooking again. And then so I ate with him. She never said a word to me. She was mad. But all the family was around. They were all eating. And then in the middle of the food that we're reaching over, knocking it over every once in a while to get the butter, pass the pepper, pass the salt, reaching over, grabbing it. And I say, you know, this thing here in the middle of the table as a sculpture, it looks a lot like your most famous sculpture up above in the souvenir shop that has the Mona Lisa wraps around it and nobody's allowed to get near. And he says, oh yeah, this is my Dulin banjo or a Dulin horse carving. It's worth, I don't know how many million. And he says, and I said, well, why is it sitting here in the middle of the table? And he says, you think I'd put a multi-million-dollar carving of mine, my most famous carving, up where people can touch it? He said, no, that's a fake. He said, I just have it here on the dinner so that we can, you know, touch it whenever we want. And I mean, it would literally fall over. They'd lift it up again.
Oh, my God.
So that's where his most famous carving is.
On the dinner table.
With everybody eating around it. If the Joukowsky family watches, hey, now we know.
Now we know. Hey, for our listeners and viewers who just joined us, we're so excited and honored to have with us today the host of Earth with John Holden, John Holden himself. You can find him at earthwithjohnholden.com on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Vimeo, and YouTube. John, your show truly is a bastion of possibilities and positivity. What do you think your effect has been on investors and other people who watch it to get inspired. And then they go on to either create companies that are making a difference in ESG, circular economy, or ESG, or they invest in companies that are doing like-minded things to fight climate change and create a better world for all of us.
Well, you know, I mean, that's kind of like all the stories. And again, this the company Star Media that I work with,
yeah,
has a staff of researchers. So they're looking for companies with that are green, that are concerned with ESG, you know, the environment, society, and governance. And you know, it always used to be that if you're investing in things, you invest either, number one, to make money, or maybe you invest to do good, you know?
Right.
But not one or the other, because if you invest to do good, then you're probably not making money. It's probably costing too much. Well, now kind of like the tables have turned, and a lot of things now, investors are looking at companies that are green, that before they'll even invest in them. And that they want to know what their environmental plans are, what they're doing for the environment. They want to know what they're doing for their communities and society. And they want to know that they're going to be meeting the governance. I mean, that, you know, by the year 2050, we're going to be net zero is the big thing, you know. And it's all about, well, if it's making cars, what about electric cars? You know, from oil, what about going to natural gas, you know, in oil exploration. So I'd done two stories on a couple of companies. One was called the MFS Investment in Boston. What was neat about that is that was back in 1924, they started the first mutual fund. So they invented the mutual fund that got people to the average Joe to be able to invest. You know, before then it was, you know, who knew about investing? Well, 1924, the first investment fund, they still, when I went and did the story there, I think they're in the Prudential Building there in downtown Boston. Really neat company. Their CEO is Carol Jeremia, G-E-R-E-M-I-A, Jeremia. She's really was passionate about, you know, what direction she takes investing. And they don't even think of investing unless the company has, you know, in their portfolios that they're doing this green or they're doing that green. And that so that when you invest, okay, then you're guaranteed that whoever is you're investing in is going to have a green, you know, say, or I mean, a green outlook. So that's all they do now, from the first mutual fund now to today, they're still doing the same responsible environmental thought, but now it's all about that it's got to be this ESG minded in order to, or else they're not going to invest in you. You know, it's all about that.
And John, give us a little teaser on some shows that we'll be looking for in 2022 that you're either taped already or you're planning on taping and covering. Give us a little teaser before we say goodbye for today.
Okay. Well, I just got back from one trip that was Germany, Spain, and now the cotton fields of Texas or Louisiana. And in Germany, it was doing a company called Mubea. And that what they do, you're not going to really understand or see that name anywhere, because they do the parts that are in a lot of cars, almost all cars, that make them lightweight. So their whole thing is making cars lightweight so that they get better gas mileage. And the whole thing now is they don't even talk about combustion engines anymore, because everybody there in Germany is going electric. And what was really interesting in their showroom is that they have a 2014 Volkswagen on display called the Leader. I think it's called the XL1. It got, and this is back in the year 2014, 2015, it got 100 kilometers per 1 liter of fuel. Okay, so put in 1 liter of fuel, you can go 100. I mean, that's like on a, you know, 1 gallon, 100 miles, you know. Right. And that was back in 2014. They only made 3 of them and they stopped, because now it's all about electric and it's all about making it lightweight. So the future cars now, it's just going to be lightweight electric vehicles. And I mean, it's whether it's Volkswagen, whether it's the other German manufacturers of cars. It's all going to be lightweight. And then in Spain, kind of interesting. Oh, this got interesting too. In Germany, there's a lot of fishnets. You talk about plastic polluting our oceans. Well, yeah. Fishnets are polluting our oceans. And so I did a company that partnered with Aquafil in Italy, and they're taking fishnets taken out of the ocean to make fiber. And then they're creating carpet, high-end carpet out of fishnet from the ocean that's all recyclable. So they're also completing the circle of taking, things from the ocean and using it again, making, high-end fiber. And then that company's called Object Carpet. And you can get really great carpet, that used to be fishnet from the ocean. And then in Spain, it was grape growing and how sustainable grape growing is done today, and the technology to make grape growing sustainable. And one thing that hasn't changed in the centuries of grape growing is that still sustainable is they still use falcons. They have a bunch of falcons in cages that are released to go after birds that eat the grapes, because they don't want to spray the grapes. That contaminates. How do you get rid of, right before harvest, you got this beautiful harvest ready to happen, but it's destroyed by starlings and birds. So how do you get rid of these birds without spraying the crop? You unleash your pet falcons and eagles. They're called Harris eagles. Wow. And they have pet names, and they put a little hood on them, and they line them up, and then they release the hoods, release them from their arms. I got to hold one too. It was pretty neat. And then it flies off, and they scare the heck the bejeebies out of the people that are the birds that are on there. And the rest of the stories, I'm doing this. I'm kind of like, well, where do I go next?
Right there. Yeah. Well, John, we're going to have you back on to continue your great journeys. And I just want to say thank you for joining us today on the Impact Podcast. I wish you continued good health and success. And we want you to be doing this show for the next 20 years. And guess what? I take back my words from earlier today. I don't wish there was 20 of you. I wish we needed 100 of you telling and sharing these great stories. For our listeners and viewers out there, to find John, you could go to earthwithjohnholden.com or find him on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Vimeo, or YouTube. John, thank you for being who you are, and thanking you for making the earth and the world a better place. I so appreciate it, and so does everyone else that are going to watch and listen to this show.
Thank you, John, for having me on. I appreciate it.
This episode of the Impact Podcast is brought to you by Closed Loop Partners. Closed Loop Partners is a leading circular economy investor in the United States with an extensive network of Fortune 500 corporate investors, family offices, institutional investors, industry experts, and impact partners. Closed Loop's platform spans the arc of capital from venture capital to private equity, bridging gaps and fostering synergies to scale the circular economy. To find Closed Loop Partners, please go to www.closedlooppartners.com.